Now, a cultural universal is this really cool idea that if we look at all the different cultures that are found in the world and we try to find the things that are different about them, we will find differences, but we will find far more in common. Cultural universals are things that are found in all cultures. I don't care what culture you come from, food is part of your culture. Your culture will do food slightly differently than another culture. It's the reason that biscuits in East Tennessee look way different than biscuits in New Jersey. And that's okay. It's allowed to be different, but they all have food in common. It's a really cool thing. Clothes, dress, the things that we wear are quite often very uniquely cultural. And that's kind of a cool thing about many cultures, is that they have just really unique things that are very artistic or cool or functional or anything, but they're very unique to that culture. But all cultures have some kind of clothes that are important, whether we're thinking about the overhaul of the miner or the Appalachian resident, or thinking about like cultural clothing from an indigenous tribe. Likewise, families are a cultural universal. All cultures recognize the idea of family in some sense. We recognize it in different ways. We recognize it to different extents. So I grew up in the sense that family was a very big idea. And it's not just people that I'm blood related to, but that people who were part of my community as a child. In fact, it often felt like many of my childhood friends were family in that sense. And same ways, families get redefined even in how we understand them as adults. Education is another good example. There's always education in all cultures. In fact, they're educating you on socialization and social institutions. That previous slide. The whole thing is that with cultural universals, we all have the same ideas. And I reiterate this time after time after time, even though all cultures do things differently, I guarantee you, when we look at it, they have far, far more things in common than they have different. Now, one of the really common things that happens is when you encounter another culture for the first time, it's a sense of just, it's shock. Culture shock, in fact, is a perfectly normal thing. Don't feel bad that it feels weird to encounter another culture for the first time. That's perfectly normal. Let me tell you about buying groceries in France. That was the first moment that I really felt culture shock in my life, and it was a bizarre experience. I walked into a grocery store, and they're very small. They're very different from the grocery stores that we have here in the United States, particularly being someone who grew up in a rural area. And I walked in, and there's not really a buggy. There's just a little basket. And I get my basket, and I'm getting some really basic things because I was a very poor college student at the time. So I'm getting some bread. The bread looked really good. And I get some ham and some jambon, I think it is, fromage, cheese. I get all these different things. I'm putting them in my basket. And I remember I walk up to the counter to check out, and I just put my basket down and I smile at the person, and she just kind of turns her head sideways and looks at me and looks at the basket and looks at me. And I'm just like, but in America, this is where they take the things out of the basket and they ring them up. And I'm like, oh, it might be different in France. Okay, no problem. I could do this. And I say, oui, oui. Bonjour, comment ça va aujourd'hui? And I start taking them out of the basket. I'm like, okay, that's a total save. Everything's going to be fine. She goes through, she checks everything out. She says a number, which I'm like, okay, I think it's this number. She gives me change back, gives me receipt, au revoir, and then looks at me. She hasn't bagged my groceries or anything, just kind of looks at me, and I'm like, oh, I bagged my groceries here, mais oui, bonjour, okay, au revoir, and I bag my groceries up, and she's like, oh, and then she freaks out. Like, she starts talking in French really fast, and I'm like, répétez-vous, s'il vous plaît. And I remember that I didn't understand what was happening, but she yanked my receipt out of my hand. And then she yanked the bread out of the basket, or out of the bag. And I was like, okay, this is strange. This is very, very strange. She took the bread, and I didn't know what to do. I was just like, comment ça va? Je voudrais un pain. I want the bread. And she said lots of things really fast, and then she handed me my receipt back, put the bread on the counter behind her, and then she handed me more money. And I was just like, but I want the bread. I'm getting sandwich material, as you can see. I've got ham and cheese and moutarde, mustard. I'm going to make a sandwich and hang out at the Eiffel Tower. It's going to be great. And I need the bread to do that. And the bread looks great. Je voudrais au bread. And this results in this hilarious exchange between the two of us that results in her calling the manager to the front And he was a very French bureaucratic looking person who was very large compared to me. And I was very intimidated by Marcel, was his name. And it was very strange because it took us going back and forth, because he didn't really speak any English and I spoke very little French, to figure out that the bread had actually expired a couple hours before she sold it to me. She noticed the label as I was getting ready to leave, and that's what caused her to freak out, because apparently, as best I understand it, it's a big no-no to sell expired bread in France, or it might just be in Paris, I'm not really sure. But that was a cultural thing, that bread needed to be fresh. There were laws set up to protect it. Now, think about this in the United States. If I get a moldy bag of bread at Kroger's and I try and leave, they're probably going to sell me that and not even raise a word about it, right? That's a total cultural difference. And for me, this was a total culture shock. In fact, Marcel and I walked back to the bread section. We found a bread that had not expired yet that day. And I mean, it expires by the hour. It was literally like a day old and had expired compared to bread that might sit at Kroger's for 3 years. And I bought the right bread and I was excited, and I picked up a bottle of wine on the way out because it was a rough day, but everything went fine. Total culture shock though. Total culture shock. I've worked also with a lot of students from other countries. In fact, when I was at the University of Tennessee at Martin, in my first job, I worked a lot with students from Saudi Arabia. And it was intriguing for me to talk to them and to hear about some of the cultural differences between their cultural experiences and what they were experiencing in the United States. And they were like, it's so strange. It feels so weird. Some things are completely the same, but other things are just completely different. And again, it was a really cool experience for me to not only have experienced culture shock, but to see how my students were also experiencing culture shock. It was really intriguing. It led me to realize that when we experience culture shock, it leads us to having two decisions to make. Now, the first perspective would be what we call an ethnocentrist perspective. This is the idea that your culture and only your culture is correct. And this one's kind of, I think, problematic. That's my opinion. The term ethnocentrism pops up on the quiz, but that's my perspective on ethnocentrism, is that it's undesirable. The idea that only your culture is correct is really short-sighted, first off, because your culture is one of thousands. But secondly, we do things differently. And remember, cultural universals show us that we have far more in common than different. So because a culture does things differently in terms of fashion, that doesn't mean that your culture has it right. It just means that your cultures do things slightly differently. The expectation that someone would speak a particular language because they're in a particular country is kind of an example of that. You know, we do our best when we visit other countries. We don't always have time to learn the entire French dictionary, and French people sometimes speak really fast and I don't understand it, and I speak in English and I appreciate that they would tolerate that. The other idea too, that people that are not like mainstream cultures are somehow wrong or backward, is another idea. I often see that too with people who talk about cultures in other places. They use things like third world country or backwards to describe them, and that's wrong. And I gotta be honest, people have described Appalachians as that way, and so it's something that I'm sensitive to and try to be aware of. We can't call other people's cultures backwards. You know, we don't know their cultures, we don't know their experiences. Instead, we need to focus on the cultural universals, the things that we have in common. In fact, we depart from an ethnocentrism lens because it's not helpful to think that you're the only person on this planet and that only your culture somehow did it right. In fact, what really works better is for you to take on a cultural relativist perspective. Cultural relativism is the idea that, our cultures can all do different things and do them differently. We can have different dress, we can have different food, we can have different norms. And it doesn't make it right or wrong. In fact, it's even not a conversation of right or wrong. It's just an acknowledgement that we do things differently. It's not even saying that we feel that it's okay, or that we support it. It's just saying, you know, there are differences. But at the same time, with cultural relativism, we're also saying, look, there's a lot of stuff in common. All right, I'm going to call it there. Now, in our last part of our lecture, we're going to talk about something called structural functionalism. This is our first sociological lens of the semester, and it's an important part of understanding why culture is so important. So, if you have questions about any of these ideas, you feel free to write me. I'm happy to chat with you. Otherwise, I'll see you in the next lecture. Take care.